it's now building up in the same direction. So the momentum has been established.
Right.
And I do not believe that until now only postal votes are being counted.
No, now it would have gone down to very few postal votes. So Chari, let's go back to you. I wish you were here in the studio. We could have seen the expression on your face. Now you're a bit far away, so we only see you when we cut the link to you. So UP, BJP doing very well, would you say? Are you happy with what you're seeing in Uttar Pradesh?
Well, I think I'm happy with what the BJP is doing in UP and Uttarakhand. It is on the expected lines.
Right.
So I think even as you mentioned about the strike rate, even if you maintain the 65%, even if the strike rate is slightly low, depending on other areas, I think UP, other regions, I think UP, the BJP should probably go beyond 225. I mean, it would be probably crossing what Kalyan Singh got. I think Kalyan Singh was 221, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
So,
right.
Crossing the Kalyan Singh mark would be what the BJP would achieve in UP. And Uttarakhand, of course, it's a clear victory.
If,
but I wanted to mention one thing about...
Go ahead.
I wanted to mention one thing about Punjab. You know, I still feel that... A big chunk of the Hindu votes could have probably gone in favor of the Congress, thereby affecting the Aam Aadmi Party. What Shekhar mentioned probably has a logic.
Shekhar and logic?
Once in a few years.
I know, it's difficult.
But let me tell you, Chari, talking about the strike rate and the proportion in Uttar Pradesh, we have, if we go back to the overall, let's go back to the strike rate. Uttar Pradesh, out of 152, BJP is just now leading in 100. If this strike rate continues, and it may or may not, because you know these are just early rounds. If this strike rate continues, the BJP would be heading for 260 odd seats. Just a little over 260?
Two-thirds.
That's what I'm saying.
260 seats. That's the kind. This proportion, if this proportion, that enough doesn't...
But we do not...
Sorry?
Yeah. There was one or two exit polls which even suggested 260 plus
for
BJP.
Yes.
I think this is the Indian poll, which was in that range.
This strike rate is likely to continue.
And that's what it seems to be so far.
So far. Yogendra, would you say that they're heading for like over 250, under 250, or too early to say? What would you?
Look, the
BJP
first,
in Uttar Pradesh.
The BSP's expectations of improving substantially and being one of the contenders seem to be out.
Out, yeah.
SP Congress, nowhere close to majority, down. And I mean, we can be reasonably confident. At the moment, of course, they are doing much worse. But minimally what we can say is this whole idea of SP Congress coming back, etc., is clearly out. And at the moment, the BJP seems to be sailing for a comfortable majority. So
comfortable
things
majority.
That people like me did not believe in half an hour ago, that is the direction in which BJP
Why did
is
you
definitely
tweet?
Headed.
I mean, like, are you crazy?
See, as I said, a hangover of the previous birth. It makes no sense. Makes no sense to do it at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Especially since you haven't even done a poll.
No poll, not even visited. So, as I said the other day, I'm neither neutral nor observer. There's this itch. Otherwise, 8 o'clock in the morning, you know, have to just get it out of your system and say, this is what I thought.
Nuts.
Being said.
Nuts.
Absolutely.
I think so. All of us tend to agree that in Uttar Pradesh, the BJP is heading towards a clear majority, if not two-thirds.
In fact, if you look at some of the heavyweights, Pranoy, of the Samajwadi Party, Azam Khan is trailing in Rampur, which is
really?
Something many would have considered unthinkable. He's trailing to the BSP, but he's trailing. His son, who's making a debut in a neighboring seat, is trailing. Aparna Yadav, who's one of the many Bahus of the Yadav clan, she's trailing in the Lucknow East seat. So it's really turning out to be
it's become
a Hindu-Muslim election in UP. Samajwadi Party and Congress have erred in dragging the Muslim voters as their only supporters in a way, and they've played along with this polarization.
But you know,
but
Shekhar,
would you blame
I
so much SP Congress, or would you blame more the BSP? Because if you look at the public rhetoric, at least they managed to stay pretty much on message. Every time Amit Shah would say something like Kasab, Dimple would convert it into computers, cycles, bicycles. So I think it was.
It's the same thing. I don't think these messages matter. I think the messages of the message of the alliance matter. What did the Congress bring to SP? As a Congress leader said to me, it's our ISO stamp to SP for UP's Muslims.
No, but
otherwise,
I think
Congress was not bringing
factors,
any vote back.
I think there were two factors at work. Hindu-Muslim is one, but I think there was a very strong caste polarization as well. You know, with the BJP being able to paint the Samajwadi Party as a purely Yadav party, and the BSP as a purely Dalit party, I found so many people saying that Mayawati to sirf apne biradari ke liye kaam karti hai aur kisi ke liye kaam nahi karti.
Are you very worried now about the current BSP position?
It seems so that OBC consolidation that we are fearing of has gone behind the BJP. That's what the was. If OBC turns toward BJP as a consolidated vote, they might sweep. That was our biggest fear, and it looked like turning to be true.
Also, we just have Abhishek Manu Singhvi with us, Pranoy. Yeah. So perhaps we can also bring him in.
Yes.
Because now we're seeing a fairly clear trend in Uttar Pradesh. The alliance doesn't appear to be working. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, how would you look at this now? Would this be seen as a sign that once again Rahul Gandhi has failed to deliver in Uttar Pradesh, in a significantly important state?
Firstly, I would still say that given past experiences, I think 10:30 is the better time to start writing obituaries and requiems for political parties, maybe 11 o'clock, especially in as large and as diverse a state as Uttar Pradesh. Number two, I do accept that if these trends persist and are correct, then it is bad for each and every political party. Why single out Rahul Gandhi? Yes, he will own up from the front. He always bites a bullet, takes it in the chest. But so will, I hope, every other political party leadership, because this is something quite remarkable if these trends persist. And this is, as you just said, much more than mere voting. It is some kind of a en bloc caste voting, and obviously those especially include the middle OBCs and the other OBCs. So I can't say anything more except that this sounds very, very unique victory for Mr. Modi, but I would still call it only after 10:30, 11, because there are large parts of Uttar Pradesh. Last time we saw in both Bihar and the other election that the trends changed to victory for the losing person. And also, given the diversity of Uttar Pradesh, I wouldn't commit yet till about 10:30.
Right. I agree with you. You still have to wait because it is a huge state. But the kind of trend where the BJP is holding on to two-thirds, it's really, in fact, over that now. It's a 65, more than 65%. Let's get an updated.
If these trends persist, it's a remarkable victory.
Right.
It's a remarkable victory.
It is a very strong trend. And I personally don't think one can talk about en bloc caste voting for BJP.
Right.
I think parties who are non-BJP, those who are opposed to Mr. Modi, have to think of something more serious. It's not merely en bloc caste voting happening for BJP.
Sure.
Something bigger
definitely
is that
not
you cannot
like
get
this.
A result like a trend like this just because you managed to get a couple of castes on your side.
Well, I think our travel showed us that Mr. Modi stays extremely popular. If anything, it's quite remarkable that past halfway in his term, he's more popular than he was in the beginning. So this is a vote for him. And I think his appeal is cutting across caste. It's not cutting across religion, it's cutting across caste.
It's an amazing victory. If this trend continues, and it's a pretty solid trend, it's an amazing victory for Mr. Modi, more than for the BJP, in fact.
Absolutely.
And it's a bigger in Uttarakhand.
And
bigger in Uttarakhand.
It means also that demonetization has not affected the BJP at all, contrary to what all of us.
It's benefited them.
That absolutely, that you know, that the sort of focus that this was a pro-poor move, it would help the poor, that obviously that message seems to have been bought by the people.
I think voters unanimously told us almost that I suffered, but this has been done with good intentions.
With good intentions.
Can we go to Puducherry's second home state? Yes, three here. The second one, Goa, which is showing surprising numbers.
Surprising numbers. Congress
have a look at Goa.
Ahead.
Because Pranav and Baja moved there, that's why it's happening. Let's have a look at Goa. Okay, we'll just get to Goa. But yes, again, Uttar Pradesh, 133 out of 199.
Wow.
This is like
two-thirds.
Amazing.
Two-thirds. It's a landslide.
Landslide.
Two-thirds. Right. Here's Goa. This is what Dorab was talking about. A struggling Congress.
Six out of eight
for the Congress in Goa. Up three since last time. Again, Goa very, very slow at counting. Relaxed, just like all of us.
We were once here till 4 o'clock in the afternoon doing Goa results. But I think it's important to remember that there were some problems the BJP was facing in Goa.
Yeah.
If you remember, there was the RSS breakaway group
yes.
led by Mr. Khanvilkar, which formed a rival front which was fighting against them.
The chief minister
was facing anti-incumbency. There was this constant question mark about whether removing Manohar Parrikar was a mistake. So the BJP was going into this election with some negatives, and perhaps that's one of the reasons which is helping the Congress.
So did the Congress. The negatives of Congress were huge. They were saddled with these six chief ministers, none with a decent reputation.
Right.
embroiled in all kinds of past memories of corruption.
Yes.
And significantly, Aam Aadmi Party, which is a small player there, came up with a fairly clean agenda. Clean chief ministerial candidate.
Yes, yes.
And they were expected to cut more into Congress votes.
But more into BJP votes.
So far.
Don't know yet.
Well, the whole thing in Goa was, would the Aam Aadmi Party cut in the Congress and would the RSS breakaway cut into the BJP?
Yeah. So
that was the trade-off. But at the moment, it's still only 8 out of 40. This is a long way to go.
Ahead. Every single poll, exit poll, put the BJP ahead.
That's right. Uttarakhand, please take a look at the Uttarakhand.
Let's have a look at Uttarakhand.
It's a sweep.
It's a sweep for BJP. Yeah.
That's right.
Uttarakhand, we have 30 out of 70 and BJP 25 out of 30.
Wow.
This is actually spillover almost same as Uttar Pradesh. It's just
absolutely.
Like,
so
in fact, even more.
There could be some of the neighboring Uttar Pradesh.
No, but again, it shows that misadventure, with declaration of president's rule and then being struck down by the Supreme. None of that has harmed the BJP at all, And everybody thought that there would be a kind of sympathy factor for Harish Rawat. And, the Amit Shah inducted these 14 Congress rebels, gave them tickets. And there was so much heartburning, in the BJP.
Yeah.
But
and Harish
Rawat
is trailing in both his seats.
Can you imagine?
And also there were four big Narendra Modi rallies in Uttarakhand. So he campaigned very aggressively
as well. That's right.
Let's just have a quick look at the so-called predictor seats in Uttar Pradesh. What are they saying? Are they all going to the BJP or any changing? Are there any? What does it look like? The predictor seats in Uttar Pradesh, and we can look at other states after that. Here it is. Quick look. Here are the predictor seats that have traditionally voted the same way as what the overall state does. BJP, Apna Dal, which is BJP. Again, mostly BJP. That's as expected, actually, that there would be. There are one or two which may still change hands, of course. Samajwadi Party and Nagina and the BSP and Bakshi Ka Talab. Yeah. And let's have a look at the safe seats, the BJP safe seats. They must be holding on to all of them. No doubt about that. Yeah, only one. Oh, two. Ayodhya, SP is leading in Ayodhya.
Mm.
Considered a really safe seat for the BJP. And Dudhi Congress.
These are safe seats based on 2014 or 2012?
No, historically safe.
Historically safe, right.
Huge margins.
They won them by more than 25% in 2014 and earlier. Used to hold them for the other seats.
Right. And again, let's just go quick sweep through each of the states and the leads position, overall leads, just to get a
picture and then discuss how robust all of this. 219, so we've got more than half the seats in, 149. Now we're
this
talking about
them close to 300.
It's stunning.
This proportion continues, it's 270.
The numbers
exactly
are really
no, but momentum always moves in the same direction.
Right.
So it will get close to 300 if
I
this
mean,
continues.
It will be a phenomenal endorsement of Narendra Modi and put him on a track for winning the 2019 general election.
Absolutely.
This is
absolutely
a huge victory if this trend continues. Let's have a look at Punjab. Oh, this is Uttar Pradesh again. Let's now go to Punjab. 148 out of 221. Phenomenal, phenomenal. Punjab, 66, over half. Congress trend of maintaining more than half continues. Aam Aadmi Party will be a little disappointed with 16.
No, since the Lok Sabha election, they picked up only one seat.
And you can see the reason for that. All exit polls did not give two figures for Akali Dal. Akali Dal is already showing two figures at halfway mark, which means Aam Aadmi Party has predominantly taken the Akali vote.
Absolutely.
And I think they focus too heavily on Sikh vote, going to Gurdwaras all the time, getting these Canadians, then all these sacrilege stories, blaming the Deras for them. And I think
this is actually,
Akalis
in a way,
have held on to some of it, some of
in
their
the
vote.
Way the politics of this, Aarti. The BJP will be happier with this than with the Aam Aadmi Party winning.
Oh, very much
because
so.
Because Aam Aadmi Party in Gujarat was becoming a bit of a worry. If they won this, they would have, Aarti.
No, if this is the final result, it will affect Delhi MCD elections.
No, absolutely. I mean, Congress ministers were quite openly saying that they would prefer BJP ministers were quite openly saying that they would prefer the Congress to win in Punjab than Aam Aadmi Party. You know, Aam Aadmi Party is a, it's not a conventional political party. And I think that they, you know, they would much prefer. So I think they feel it's more difficult to handle and, you know, it poses more of a challenge to Narendra Modi and the BJP than the Congress does.
But also, Aam Aadmi Party is a shock and awe party.
Yeah, you never know what will happen.
You never know what their policy is, you don't know what their philosophy is.
Congress is becoming a bit predictable, so they want the Congress to win.
Well, the issue is that Congress would have won in Punjab. That was pretty evident. Aam Aadmi Party, both their, they haven't opened their account in Goa as yet.
Sorry, just to, while you're speaking, these are shots from Lucknow. Everybody shouting Har Har Modi. So go ahead. Sorry, carry on.
Yeah, so people, Aam Aadmi Party were just, you know, patting its back a bit too early, you know, trying to, and they were over ambitious. And they were in a hurry to become a national party. They did not consolidate their position in Delhi, but they just ventured into too many states. And the results are showing that.
I think, in fact, Pranav, we might have one of the Aam Aadmi Party's shock and awe politicians with us. Somnath Bharte is with us. If we can just go across to him. Mr. Bharte, thank you for joining us. Sorry again to keep you waiting. But when you look at now what is emerging from Punjab, and if these trends hold true, what would you say would be a mistake you made in Punjab?
Well, that's, it's early little for us to conclude anything of that kind. But I think maybe in an hour's time, it's 9:20 till 10:30, we'll have better picture. And it's unbelievable if it continues. Because we are expecting still a very heavy mandate in Punjab, and I think this trend would reverse.
You should have named Mr. Kejriwal as a chief ministerial candidate, as was hinted in the campaign, but it never happened.
I don't think so. That could be the reason, but it's for the party, for all of us to sit and decide and think if this trend at all continues. But it's early for me, and it's early for the party to comment on this. I have no words to express. But then, we had put in the absolute hard work, and Mr. Kejriwal himself had been in Punjab for months, and the way we all tried hard to in Punjab. I don't know what, why this train should continue.
But,
One of the panelists in today's discussion was talking about policy, that Aam Aadmi Party is is unpredictable in policies. I don't know which policy Aam Aadmi Party is unpredictable in. I mean, if BJP is comfortable with Congress, it's not because of the policy, it's because of the friendliness. They are friends with each other, and they know that they will not prosecute each other at all. It's Aam Aadmi Party which poses a challenge. If you look at the budget which Manish Sisodia presented yesterday in the assembly, day before, that is unbelievable. The kind of policies to empower the ordinary citizen in education, healthcare,
right?
It has never happened before.
Somnath Bharti,
policies, when we talk about, then we are much ahead than them.
Somnath Bharti, you're saying it's early days and the trend may reverse. But you look disappointed with the current trend. Are you very disappointed right now? Are you shocked?
No, I'm not. I mean, this is because we are all new to politics. I have much of understanding of all these figures. But that we all just believe in that we do hard work on the ground. We do hard work in the assembly. We do hard work for the people. And that's what we keep doing.
Right, but you're not even actually sweeping Malwa, which is a bit of a surprise, and you feel that way that situation may turn as more rounds are counted, is it?
Sir, I mean, that's what I mean. We have not, I'm not before a TV this moment, I don't see the figures. But if you say, I'm hearing from the panelists and from your discussion, the Punjab, it seems that the early trends are towards Congress, but that's not going to continue. And believe me, 10:30 possibly trends will reverse, and this could be the early lead for Congress from the postal ballot.
At the moment, if we can just go across to Abhishek Singhvi, Abhishek, just again qualifying that these are leads, it looks like for the Congress, Punjab may end up becoming the only consolation prize in these elections. Goa, we don't know yet, but with Punjab at least.
I think Manipur also they are pulling ahead.
No. Manipur as well, okay. But in terms of the bigger states, would you take that and be happy with that? Or is the UP, the BJP landslide in UP a much bigger setback?
I want to make 3 or 4 points, Vasu. First of all, let us be clear that if the UP results are like they suggest on the trends, and I still believe very strongly that we should hold our horses till 10:30 to 11 a.m., then everybody collectively, you, me, commentators, pollsters, everybody's got it wrong for the last several months, both on UP and on demonetization, except one or two polls which came recently. Secondly, I'm not one of those who believes that a wrong thing becomes a right thing merely because of electoral verdict. Demonetization will remain a historical blunder in terms of economic policy, logic, etc., etc. But I will concede that somewhere Mr. Modi, if these trends persist, has caught the public imagination remarkably. It does not validate demonetization, although I'm sure that will be claimed. It does not make it right because there's not a single person on logic, economic policy, etc., who can support it. But yes, it shows how you can sell a message convincingly. As far as the election results are concerned, 3 states are in the reckoning for the Congress, not one. Let me correct you. Apart from Punjab, we're very hopeful in Manipur, and either single largest or otherwise somehow being in the reckoning for making the government in Goa. But obviously, that's not the same thing as Uttar Pradesh. That's the king state, if I may say so. On demonetization, the results, I think you have to rewind back to November. Possibly the narrative was got wrong by everyone in Delhi. And that includes you, me, the channels, the discussants, and the politicians. So I think, yes, you have to doff your hat at a remarkable victory there in Uttar Pradesh.
I mean, at the end of the day, Abhishek, we can live with a bad call. But the thing is that politically for you, this is something that virtually may write off 2019 for the Congress yet again. Somewhere along the line, I mean, is it enough to say that you couldn't read it? Is it also time for Rahul Gandhi, for the Congress leadership to accept responsibility that you didn't run a focused enough campaign? There was a Khat Sabha which started, then that collapsed. Till the last minute, it wasn't clear whether there was an alliance or not. Priyanka Gandhi didn't step into the fray. Somewhere along the line, were serious mistakes made by the party and its leadership?
I know that I am repeating this caveat every time, but assuming that this happens, let us be very clear. We've had great victories earlier, and we've had bad defeats, including the 2014. And as far as owning of responsibility is concerned, I think our leaders, the Congress President and the Vice President, have taken the bullet in the chest. They have stood up and owned up. They have owned up more gracefully and much more in quantity terms in defeats than taking credit for victories, which also happened over 10 years. Yes, I think it will require a major restructuring. It will require a fundamental rethinking of strategies, and that will undoubtedly happen, because this means that all the other parties have been marginalized in UP, not only us. And that's the same exercise that have to go on everywhere. But I agree with you that somewhere, and this is not a BJP victory at all. If it is, it will be a Modi victory. There's no doubt about that also. He would get the credit. I'm not at all sure how much the BJP stands crippled if Modi is not there as a campaign leader. So therefore, that's another issue. But you can rest assured that fundamental issues of restructuring will be discussed in case this result persists. Although I'm still much more hopeful than the trend show.
Right. Thanks very much, Abhishek. Much, much more confident than the trend. So let's now quickly go through again. And it's pretty clear now in Uttarakhand also.
In three out of five states, we can be reasonably sure of what we are looking at. The trend has stabilized now.
Uttar Pradesh?
Uttarakhand, it's a clear, clear big victory for
BJP. Huge victory for BJP.
Uttar Pradesh, now we need not be uncertain and so on. The only thing that we are talking about is the margin of BJP's majority. Is it a clear majority? Is it an overwhelming majority? Those are the things we are looking at.
Right.
And in Punjab too, now it has reasonably stabilized.
Yes, the Congress is
headed for a clear majority. Aam Aadmi Party is doing just slightly better than what they did in 2014. They needed to do much better.
So in all fact, the three down states, three down seats at the moment.
They're
since
down
2014,
now.
Yeah.
Down from 2014 is, of course, a terrible news. I mean, it's generally tragic for Punjab, what we are witnessing. But it is so in these three states, we can be reasonably sure of the overall verdict now. So I'm not saying calling or anything.
No.
But it's quite clear.
The trends
trend
are very clear.
States,
are
if this trend sustains in Punjab, Akali Dal will end up ahead of 20. And that has changed all the calculations, because Aam Aadmi Party was supposed to take all the vote, a lot of which now Akali Dal has retained. Maybe the Deras delivered on their promise to Akali Dal, but that is the vote that Aam Aadmi Party wanted to make a difference.
But you know the trends, what is interesting is that the trends completely knock out the theory of the silent voter. You remember we kept hearing about the silent voter in Punjab, the silent voter in UP.
To be fair, I think there was a bit of a silent Congress voter in Punjab.
In Punjab, yes.
The Congress.
Aam Aadmi Party was all.
I don't know.
Aam Aadmi Party was fashionable.
But Aam Aadmi Party kept claiming that they were getting the silent vote. That was what they kept claiming, that they were getting the silent voter.
Yeah.
And frankly, I found the Congress voter to be pretty vocal, because I came back feeling that the Congress was doing very well in Punjab, and I was finding it very difficult to make that call.
In the Akali Alliance, there are two parts. In fact, it's the Akalis who haven't taken such a hit. It's the BJP. They've taken a bigger hit in sheer numbers. BJP is down, they had 11 seats, they're down 10. Akalis are 21. They are down 8. So Akalis, who are twice the size of the BJP, have taken a lower hit than the BJP. So the BJP actually that's collapsed.
So the two things about two Punjab. Partners. One is the point that Shekhar made earlier. In the urban areas, the urban predominantly Hindu vote decisively goes for Congress. And about rural areas, the one point that many analysts missed, Aarti, was that the profile of Aam Aadmi Party in Punjab is not the same as in Delhi. In Delhi, Aam Aadmi Party was, at least in the previous election, party of the downtrodden, Dalits, poor, everyone.
Yeah.
In Punjab, Aam Aadmi Party was not the party of the downtrodden. It was the party of the most vocal section of Punjab peasantry, the Jat Sikhs. They were leading it.
It was also a party of the defectors.
Yeah, I mean, at some stage, they brought in everyone in a complete desperation to